am I? Sorry.
Here at Trinity Presbyterian Church. If you are newer to our church family, or if you're worshiping with us online, we hope this time of worship is meaningful for you and your family. Please note that there is a congregational meeting after worship. It will be brief for the election of officers, and those names are printed in your bulletin. If you are a visitor, you're absolutely welcome to stay. The meeting, we do not anticipate it lasting long, and you can see how we do things democratically here in the Presbyterian Church. Please also note there will be a ladies' luncheon on May 28th, and you can find more information about that in your bulletin. And please RSVP so that we know to expect you, but that's always a fun day for the ladies in our church. And now let us continue to prepare our hearts for worship.
Thank you.
Thank you, Jim and Carol. Amen indeed. And now let's move into the call to worship. How lovely is your dwelling place, O Lord of hosts. My soul longs indeed, it faints for the courts of the Lord. My heart and my flesh sing for joy to the living God. Even the sparrow finds a home, and the swallow a nest for herself, where she may lay her young at your altars, O Lord of hosts, my King and my God. Happy are those who live in your house, ever singing your praise. Happy are those whose strength is in you, in whose heart are the highways of Zion. As they go through the valley of Baca, they make it a place of springs. The early rain also covers it with pools. They go from strength to strength. The God of gods will be seen in Zion. O Lord God of hosts, hear my prayer. Give ear, O God of Jacob. Behold our shield, O God. Look on the face of your anointed, for a day in your courts is better than a thousand elsewhere. I would rather be a doorkeeper in the house of my God than live in the tents of wickedness. For the Lord God is a sun and shield. He bestows favor and honor. No good thing does the Lord withhold from those who walk uprightly. O Lord of hosts, happy is everyone who trusts in you. Please stand for our opening hymn. I invite the congregation to be seated.
Amen and amen. Thank you, choir. At this time, we invite the children forward for the children's message. Morning. Thanks for being here today. And you guys are singing with our worship band next week in Kid Worship, so we're excited about that. Oh, it's okay. Don't worry about it. So I want to tell you, raise your hand if you've ever rang a doorbell. Have you ever rang a doorbell? Raise your hand if you've ever done that. Okay.
I rang a bell in church.
Oh, you ring the big bell in our church. Yes, that's kind of like a doorbell. Yep, I like it. Yeah, there you go. So you all have gone up to someone's door and you hit the button and then it makes a noise, right? Like ding dong. And that's how someone knows you're at the door. And I was thinking about how earlier this year, Rocky and I went to visit our friends in Maryland and they knew we were coming, but they didn't know exactly when we'd get in the driveway. And so we were so excited when we went up to their doorway and we hit the doorbell, right? And it goes ding dong. And then what happens? They open the door and they're like, yay, you know, the Crayleys are here. Yeah, like, hey, hi. Okay, so we do this thing every Sunday called the call to worship. So it's okay if you don't have your bulletin. Right here, the call to worship. This week it was Psalm 84. The call to worship is us ringing Jesus' doorbell. And we're saying, hey, we're here, and we're ready for worship, and we're excited to be with you today. And Jesus always opens that door, right, and is so excited that we've come to be with him on a Sunday morning. And I'm going to be real. Sometimes when we ring doorbells, we're a little nervous, right? In trick or treat, when I was a kid, we had to ring a lot of doorbells. People didn't sit outside with candy. And so, you know, sometimes you ring a doorbell and you're like, I don't know how this is going to go. And so sometimes we come to church and we're not in a good mood. Yeah. You're a little nervous sometimes. I know, because you don't know. And sometimes we come to church a little nervous, or we're just not sure because we don't feel good that day, you know, but we do the call to worship. We ring Jesus' doorbell, and Jesus always says, yay, I'm so happy you're with me today. So that's what the call to worship is all about. We're ringing the doorbell and saying, we're ready for worship, and Jesus is saying, I'm so excited you're here. So let's pray. God, we're really excited these kids are here. And we're excited at how, Jesus, you are with them every day. And so thanks for worship and how it puts our hearts in a place that helps us hear you better. And so help us keep listening for your voice, Jesus, in the songs and in the prayers and in the scripture and in the sermon today. And especially in the words and faces of the church people around us. Amen. Hey, thanks for coming. So you're staying. Why do we say amen? Oh man, that's a good question. I can answer this. I know this. Okay, so they say amen in the Bible, and it means like, let it be. Is that what Bob McCrite's gonna help me here? He's also a pastor. Does that sound good to you, Bob, Mr. Pastor Bob McCrite? So amen is actually in the Bible. It was a Jewish word, and it's like a period at the end of the sentence. It's like, yes, ma'am. So that's why we yell it after great music and we say it after prayers. It's like the period. It's like the moment. Good question. Awesome. Wow. Good stuff. Hey, you have a good worship service. You guys are going back to your seats. Hey, thanks. So we have a God that is always excited to see us and forgive us and love us, even when we aren't perfect. And that's what the prayer of confession is all about. So join with me in the prayer of confession. It's responsive. When the lawnmower won't start or dinner is burned, oh Lord, you are with us. As we wait for the kids to finish practice or garden in our backyard, oh Lord, you are with us. as we run, jump, and throw at the track meet, or serve others in our community. Oh Lord, you are with us. In the classroom, the boardroom, and in our room at assisted living. Oh Lord, you are with us. When we are in the hospital or when we are on the bus. Oh Lord, you are with us. Forgive us, Jesus, for seeking you only in the high and holy places of our lives, rather than realizing that all of our days, each moment and each hour, are lived in the heart of your divine love. Hear the good news of the gospel. In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. Thanks be to God. Please stand. Tradition of those who have gone before us, let us proclaim what we believe using the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. You may be seated. Cassie Washel has our first scripture reading.
Good morning. I have my glasses today. When then are we to say about these things? If God is for us, who is against us? He who did not withhold his own son, but gave him up for all of us, will he not with him also give us everything else? Who will bring any charge against God's elect? It is God who justifies. Who is to condemn? It is Christ Jesus, who died, yes, who was raised, and who is at the right hand of God, who indeed intercedes for us. Who will separate us from the love of Christ? Will hardship or distress or persecution or famine or nakedness, or peril, or sword? As it is written, for your sake we are being killed all day long. We are accounted as sheep to be slaughtered. No, in all these things we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I am convinced that neither death nor life, nor angels nor rulers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord.
Thank you, Cassie. Let us pray. Holy God, we are more than conquerors. And it is good to be reminded that nothing in this life can separate us from your love for us. And so this morning, O God, as we gather after another busy week, we give you thanks for hands. Hands lifted in praise. We give you thanks for manicured hands and hands stained with grease or soil. We give you thanks for strong hands and those gnarled with age. We give you thanks for praying hands and baking hands, holy hands, weeding and mulching hands, used as wave offerings across the land. We thank you for hands that rock babies and give you special thanks today for the birth of the McCann baby and the Wise baby this week. And we look forward to meeting them in our worship service one day to come. We ask a blessing on those families, O God. God, we thank you for all of the hands of hardworking saints, whether hard-hatted or steel-booted, head ragged or aproned, blue-collared or three-piece suited. We give you thanks for their work in this world. Lord, even as we lift our hands in praise to you, we ask you to be a guiding hand in situations in our lives and in our world. Be with the names and faces we brought in here today as concerns on our hearts. Lord, we remember the family of Nancy Watson and pray for Jeremy and Sarah and their families in the loss of their cousin, Brett, who passed away at age 28 in a car accident. Lord, we ask that you be with his wife, Samantha, and their new six-month-old baby, as they deal with this unspeakable tragedy of life. Surround this family in your love and walk with them through this darkness. Lord, we also remember all families who are facing grief and loss. We pray for the people of Russia and Ukraine. We pray for people who live in the countries of the Middle East and amidst terrible conflict. Lord, we remember families who are moving through unrest in Africa and pray especially for children and teenagers who go to school every day and worry about danger. Lord, closer to home, be with everyone battling cancer. Be with those who wake up every day wondering if their mental illness will come knocking on their door. Be with everyone anxiously awaiting a test result. Walk with them through this time of waiting. We remember the family of Denny Miskovich, that you would be with them in their time of grief, and be with everyone who is missing someone they love today. We thank you, God, for the tremendous sacrifices made by those who have gone before us in this life. And we give you thanks for those who serve among us today. We thank you for our local police, for first responders. We give you thanks for the military and their families. We ask that you would be with Michael Stone as he heads out into international waters this month. We pray that you would be with Russell, his brother, as he serves in the Army Reserve. And we give you thanks for all of our veterans and their service and for the sacrifices of their families. God, thank you for the saints in our life, the everyday saints who changed our world one loving act at a time. May we learn how to walk wisely from their examples of faith and dedication and worship and love. We pray all of this using the words that Jesus Christ taught us to pray together, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. We want to say thanks again for the generous gift of your time. We had a lot of folks join us at Mercer Mission Possible. Over 20 folks from Trinity came to help clean up Brandy Springs Park, but there were about 40 people from our community total there. And so if some of us are limping or seem a little achy this morning, it's because there was lots of mulching and brush attacking and weeding, and things are looking a lot better there. Oh geez, there I am. That's the only time I worked. They took a picture and then I rested. So we mulched around the trees. Layla was a great help. And we even got a compliment from someone in the neighborhood, said, "This park is looking so much better. Thank you for all of your help through the years." And so the community notices. So they're chipping all of this brush that was just laying around in the woods. And a big thank you to Woodman Tree Service for their help with this. And so we are making a difference year after year at our local park. And so thanks to everyone for the generous gift of your time. And the community notices that the park is looking better, and they notice how churches and community members are stepping up to help. And so thanks for your generosity. Please remain seated for our middle hymn.
Thank you.
give you thanks for the ways you show up, not just in this space, but outside in the community, and how we get to be a part of it in our day jobs, in our retirement work, and in our volunteering. And so thank you for the generous hearts and finances and spirits and prayers of people of this church, that we might continue to share your love with our community and our world. Amen. You may be seated. Our second scripture reading this morning is from Galatians chapter 3, verses 23 to 29. Listen for the word of the Lord. Now, before faith came, we were imprisoned and guarded under the law until faith would be revealed. Therefore, the law was our disciplinarian until Christ came, so that we might be justified by faith. But now that faith has come, we are no longer subject to a disciplinarian. For in Christ Jesus, you are all children of God through faith. As many of you were, as you were baptized into Christ, have clothed yourselves with Christ. There is no longer Jew or Greek. There is no longer slave or free. There is no longer male and female, for all of you are one in Christ Jesus. And if you belong to Christ, then you are Abraham's offspring, heirs according to the promise. Let us pray. Holy God, we believe.
Help.
Amen. So who are you wearing today? It's a question that red carpet reporters ask movie stars on their way to an awards show or to the Met Gala. They'll say, who are you wearing today? And the movie star will say, oh, I'm wearing Gucci. I'm wearing Armani. I'm wearing Ralph Lauren today. They're asking about their clothing. Who are you wearing? Who are you wearing today? It's not a question we often ask here in Western PA, but maybe we should, because who are you wearing is exactly the question that Paul is asking all of us today, as he asked the Galatians, who are you wearing? It's the question Paul asks us today. Identities. We put on identities like they are clothes in our closet. Now, some of us have a big closet, like a walk-in closet. We have lots of identities. We're a mother, we're a daughter, we're a wife, we're a Sunday school teacher and a coach and a friend, and then we've got our day job. Some of us maybe have less identities in life, fewer. We have a smaller closet. We have a capsule wardrobe of identities, if you will, but all are important. Sometimes the things we do or the activities we're a part of can give us an identity in life. Some of you out there that I see this morning wear a uniform, and it gives you an identity. Sometimes we find an identity from our job. We have some folks in our congregation that wear a lab coat on a regular basis. Sometimes the school we go to or the school we went to can give us an identity. And the activities we do can give us an identity, right? You're a runner, you're a jumper, you're a thrower, you're a pitcher, you're a golfer, you're a farmer, you're a cheerleader. Those things give us identities as well. This summer, we learned that you don't just listen to Taylor Swift, you are a Swiftie. It's a lifestyle. But there are other things that give us identity as well. Have you noticed that the Scotch-Irish clan system is still alive and well in our part of the world. So when we tell stories about one another, we will say, as we tell the story, oh, she's a Welson, he's a Douglas, he's a Buchanan, he's a Moose, they're a Guywitz, and we all nod knowingly, right? Even if we have never met that person in our entire life, oh, they're a Courtney, then we know, right? Even if we've never met them, oh, we know, because we know their family. And so family clans can give us an identity as well. But sometimes there are hard things that can get stuck on us that become an identity, right? Maybe it's a mistake we made. Maybe it's a regret we had. Maybe it's an accident. Maybe it's something we said to someone and we would love to take it back. Or maybe it's something someone said to us as a kid, and we just can't let go of that mistake or that degree we didn't finish, that decision we made, and pretty soon this stuff just like sticks on us and it kind of strangles us like a coat that zipped up too high. Who are you wearing? Paul asks. What identities and stories and thoughts are you dragging with us? Diagnoses. And are you ready to let go of them? Paul asks. Are you ready to take off all of that horrible stuff, those stories and those beliefs that you are carrying with you? And are you ready to put on Christ? It's a decision we make every day to put on Christ. When you and I were baptized, when we asked Jesus Christ into our hearts, we were clothed in Christ Jesus. What does it mean to be clothed in Christ Jesus? It means that when God looks at us, God just sees Jesus. Sure, God sees us, but God sees Jesus' righteousness and holiness and goodness and love and perfection. When God looks at us, God sees Jesus and his goodness and his eternal life. And so on and on again throughout the New Testament, as we're looking at the story, whether we're looking at Romans as a letter of Paul or his letter to the church in Colossians or Philippians or Ephesians or Galatians, as we read together, again and again, Paul is saying to them, are you ready to let it go? Are you ready to take off your old ways? Are you ready to put on Christ? And so in Galatians, you heard me read this morning, he says, you silly Galatians, who has bewitched you? Such an interesting word. He says, are you ready to get rid of your old self and put on your new self in Christ? And as Cassie read from Romans, there is nothing that can separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus. And so Paul will say in Romans, put on Christ. And to the Colossians, clothe yourself in Christ. And so as you are reading the story of the Bible and as you're reading through the New Testament, we watch Paul again and again, clothe yourselves in Christ, clothe yourselves in Christ. It is our gift. And clothing ourselves in Christ Jesus is a choice we make every morning when we wake up. Where's our identity found? It's to be found in Jesus Christ. But let's be real. We are saved by grace through faith. And so putting on Christ every morning when we wake up is more about what Jesus does for us than what we do for him. It's about what Jesus does for us, if we would only let him. So when I was a pastor in Texas, I spent some sleepless nights praying for the daughter of a member of our congregation who was lost in Big Bend State Park in Texas. So in her story, Outside of Nowhere, Kathy Fry writes that she and her husband, Rick, have been married for 12 years. And they got married in Big Bend National Park. And so they decided to go back there for their 12th anniversary to celebrate. And so the plan was just to go on like a day hike, like you and I have all done in parks before. But due to a series of unfortunate events, they got lost at the state park. And nobody knew they were lost to start looking for them. And so they wandered the desert for days. They only had a few granola bars and some water bottles that they had taken with them, but they lost the trail, the cairns were confusing, and they just couldn't find their way back. And so after 2.5 days of wandering in the desert, eventually in the midst of that, they found a spring, and it was like a miracle, and they could refill their water bottles, but they had to get out because nobody knew to search for them. And so after 2.5 days, Kathy is exhausted from dehydration and lack of food. And she says, I'm just staying here. You've got to go. You've got to go find me help. And so she laid down in the shade of a mesquite tree, which is really more like a bush. It's very small. And she laid there and she said, this is where I will be when you come back to find me with the rescuers. And so her husband, Rick, went on without her. They had kids at home, right? They were looking at the bigger picture. And so he went on, and by a miracle, he recognized a car in the distance and then found their car and where it was parked. And he drove as fast as he could to the ranger station and said, we're lost, and my wife is out there, and she has no food and no water. She was living by eating cactus. And so they brought in 40 rescue workers, and at that point, we knew to pray that she was lost. And they began searching for her, and they could not find her for days. And at the end of day 5, they were interviewing her husband again, and one of the rescue workers realized that for a man who was absolutely exhausted, he took really big steps. And so maybe they had covered more ground in their hike than anyone realized. Rick was also a photographer, and so they asked to see the pictures on his camera again, and they realized they needed to expand their search area. And so at noon on day 6, further out than they'd ever looked before, they yelled her name, and she yelled, help. And they found her under her tree, in a ravine, just hours away from death. Her entire body was shutting down. And when they found Kathy, the rescuers noticed she wasn't wearing any clothing. Because when you're dehydrated and you're starving and you're hallucinating, you make bad decisions. And so the first thing the rescuers did is what? They took off their clothing and they put it on her. They wrapped her in their outside uniforms, those ones with the patches that say rescue workers and I'm a state park ranger. They wrapped her in their clothing and then blankets and carried her home. That's what Jesus does for us. Jesus seeks us out, wraps us in his goodness and his eternal life and his love, and carries us home every day of our life. We all need saving. We all feel lost in our own life story. We all have days when we are running short on living water. And Jesus comes, and Jesus seeks us out and saves us. And so, the question remains every day we wake up, who are you wearing? Let us pray. Holy God, we all need saving.
We all need rescuing.
We all need to be wrapped in your love. Romans reminds us that there is nothing that can separate us from your love for us. But every day, may we choose to put on you, so that all these things we do in life don't identify us, only you and your love. And oh God, when we get older and things fall away and we can't shovel mulch anymore and we are retired and the kids move away and we wonder who we are and what we're to be about in this world, as we face all those losses, remind us, oh God, again, that we do our lives wrapped in you, which makes us always and forever beloved children of God. Amen. Please stand for our closing hymn. And we've heard Paul in Galatians, and I want to share with you his words to the Colossians. And this is the Message translation. You're done with that old life. It's like a filthy set of ill-fitting clothes that you've stripped off and put in the fire. Now you're dressed in a new wardrobe, Every item of your new way of life is custom made by the Creator, with His label on it. All the old fashions are now obsolete. Words like Jewish and non-Jewish, religious and irreligious, insider and outsider, uncivilized and uncouth, slave and free, mean nothing. From now on, everyone is defined by Christ. Everyone is included in Christ. So, chosen by God for this new life of love, dress in the wardrobe God picked out for you. Compassion, kindness, humility, quiet strength, discipline. Be even-tempered, content with second place, quick to forgive an offense. Forgive as quickly and as completely as the Master forgave you. And regardless of what else you put on, wear love. It's your basic, all-purpose garment. Never be without it. And so go out into this world and go in peace and have courage. Return no one evil for evil, but strengthen the faint-hearted, support the weak, care for those who suffer, love and serve the Lord. In the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, and let all God's people say, Alleluia. Amen.